coming out. Right. So I'm going to tell you a little bit, just a little bit this evening about a question and some possible answers to the role of quantum mechanics in biology, which is something which is a rather old subject actually, but has seen a big resurgence over the last about 5 or 10 years. And I'm going to focus on photosynthesis, which is being actively pursued in, in these ponds, bacterial ponds in Yellowstone. So let me first of all give you a little bit of an overview. So there actually are quite a few topics in biology where people are currently very actively investigating the role of quantum effects. What I will talk about mostly is plants and bacteria photosynthesis, whether green plants or actually thousands of meters below the surface of the ocean, where there's no direct sunlight, but there's black body radiation from vents, hot vents. People are also interested in how birds navigate over thousands of miles from north to south. The mechanism of smell and also motion of ions through ion channels, which is important for all living systems, and finally the brain. I'm going to focus though on photosynthesis in this talk because this is a system where there is most experimental evidence. There are theoretical proposals for all of these, and you probably know some of the brain things, which are even some of the oldest theoretical proposals. But it's really where, in the photosynthetic work, that the modern methods of nanotechnology and bubble new methods in spectroscopy have given us some new insights experimentally into phenomena that might have quantum mechanical explanations. So, and on a sort of deep fundamental level, this question in biology, which is not normally an area in which one seeks to understand things in terms of quantum mechanics, it comes back to this boundary between quantum and classical, which is often discussed, which is not really a sharp boundary, and it's certainly not a boundary that's well understood today, even getting close to 100 years after the development of quantum mechanics. Normally, this is this is a sort of humorous depiction of the boundary from Wojciech Jurek, which shows how normal world you come to some place where it's shown here as a sharp boundary, where these strange things happen. There are clouds which are sort of dividing and coming together again. Everything's a little bit wavy. There are cats that are right there. So this is a humorous depiction of some of the features of quantum mechanics. But of course, this boundary, which is very, very hard to describe, is not a sharp boundary. But looking at things in biological systems, as I hope I'll convince you, does give you a sense of, enables you to probe this boundary a little bit. Okay, so there's the historical word, the long roots of quantum biology, although it's a very much a buzzword now. It's actually a very old term, and it certainly is an old topic. It was Bohr, who, after he finished with atomic physics, turned his attention to biology and was seeking a complementarity principle in biology. Or Jordan, it was Jordan who coined the term quantum biology in about 1930. But the first person who was a true quantum biologist, I would say, is Max Del Brooke, who was also a quantum physicist. He was also a student of Bohr. Like Bohr and Jordan, instead of sitting in his office and talking about biology, he actually went to the lab and he sat down and worked together with two biologists, a geneticist and a photobiologist, who would now be called a chemical physicist probably. And they did a lot of seminal work on probing the structure of what at that time was called the genetic material and its mutations, characterizing these mutations with X-rays. So this is really the first quantum probe of biological structure and also function. And it was an implicit acknowledgement of the need to understand the detailed molecular structure of functional biological entities. And that's really what we're still about today in this field. So the overall driving force here is really the fact that the tools which biologists are developing, biologists and physicists and chemists all together, are developing are probing biological structures and systems at ever decreasing length scales and also decreasing time scales these days. We're really doing this today at an unprecedented spatial and temporal resolution and getting insight into the behavior of biological systems. On the other hand, we're also interested, the biologists are understanding a lot about the function as one goes down to the molecular level. And everyone recognizes that there is a length scale and a time scale at which quantum effects will become important. And the question, really, for us who are coming into this field of biology from physics or chemistry is, okay, so we're working down here, and we can document how things work, but the big question is really, can we take information, what we learn here, back up into the higher scale where the function is really important for life? So the question that will, I think, still be here at the end of this talk is whether quantum coherence is relevant biological function. But what I'm going to show you today is basically how people have documented it and how we understand it, not what it's for. So what we're really looking at here is the second era of quantum biology, which is the era of quantum dynamical effects. This really is pushed by the experimental innovation, largely in recent years from the quantum science and technology of new generations of dynamical probes. So in photosynthesis, what we're interested in here is actually just the very first part of photosynthesis. So here's a schematic of the process by which light is absorbed by green plants or bacteria. A number of reactions occur and chemistry happens and sugars and energetic materials are made. But at the very tip here, the process of light absorption, the light is converted into essentially electron hole pairs by a set of pigments which form what's called the antenna of the light harvesting system. And they're characterized by both having an energetic funnel, which is depicted here, in the change of colors of the pigments being absorbing the light, and also a spatial funnel. So the energy is transferred from one region in the chloroplast and the leaf to another. So when we're looking at quantum effects here, everybody today is looking at this initial process of light transduction from photons, or energy transduction from photons to electron hole pairs, particularly electrons, and it's associated with a spatial translation of the energy. So let's say a little bit about photosystem 2, which is the main light harvester, one of the two light harvesters and reaction centers inside green plants. This really is an amazing machine, and it's depicted here on the left, and the arrow shows the path or acutative path by which the energy from light is first of all absorbed by a molecule chlorophyll over here and then transmitted through this set of complexes inside, this is what we normally refer to as a super complex, to the reaction center where the charge separation occurs. And if you think, so this is a sort of artistic representation of a tree, very appropriate for this laser meeting. And if you think of how much chlorophyll is actually doing the work of generating the energy for this tree, here's the chlorophyll, little chlorophyll molecule over here, it's actually a remarkable calculation. There's only about 140 grams of chlorophyll per tree. And of that 140 grams, only about 500 milligrams, so 0.5 of a gram, is actually the chlorophylls which are involved in this first step of photosynthesis. It's really a remarkably small number of molecules involved in generating a huge amount of energy. And here's a little bit of the structure of the photosynthetic apparatus. So inside the leaves, there are these chloroplast structures, which consist of these layered membranes here. Inside the membrane are these all-important molecules, the supercomplexes of PS2 and PS1. And then here's where ATP is made. And this entire system is really truly amazing because not only does it function with this small amount of chlorophyll to generate the energy, but it's also a self-repairing machine. About once every hour, this entire complex is removed, transported somewhere else in the membrane, and repaired and brought back. And we have really basically no idea how that happens. It's absolutely amazing. There are many things more amazing than actually the quantum part of the light absorption in photosynthesis. It's really truly mind-boggling. It's really the most sophisticated nanomachine we know. I think one can say this. So here's a little summary of the quantum effects. Firstly, the reason why everyone's fascinated by this is the fact that the efficiency in terms of number of photons absorbed to electron hole pairs being produced is virtually one. It can be 99.9%. It's typically less than that, but in virtually every species known, it can, under the right conditions, operate at about 95% or higher. That's a uniquely high efficiency for a biological system. It's not to be confused with the energy efficiency. The energetic efficiency of photosynthesis is very low, but this quantum efficiency in the sense of how many quanta of energy in to quanta of energy out of this first step is unsurpassed. And so here's a cartoon for a biological, for a bacterial system. So the energy might be absorbed here from the sun and then it'll be transferred over here to the reaction center. That's distances of up to 30 nanometers. Energy travels over here in 1 nanosecond. And experiments, which I'll summarize only very briefly, reveal that this transport has wave-like or quantum coherent energy transfer. So one can think of this qualitatively if you're not a physicist or don't think in other terms about coherences. Think about why this might happen is imagine a soccer ball and a golf ball going over a rough landscape. Well, the soccer ball will actually travel faster or further because it's larger and it's not so sensitive to the holes in the golf course, whereas the golf ball will likely get trapped. So that's a very rough idea about why it might be advantageous to have some kind of coherent motion because its energy is spread out over a rough energy landscape. Now, there's a lot of theoretical work done on this, and all the theoretical work indicates that this coherence contributes about 10% to the efficiency. It also shows that natural systems are optimal with respect to all parameters of the system, and we also know experimentally that there's no artificial system that's competitive with this efficiency here. There's no photovoltaic system or any kind of artificial system which has this kind of efficiency for the initial step of absorption of light. And this I'll say a little bit about at the end. This is one of the advantages we believe that there's actually the critical advantages that is conferred by the coherence. Okay, so the question here is that for many, many years, the canonical picture was that the light from the sun or blackbody radiation is absorbed, is quantized, photon, everyone is fine with that. It's absorbed by individual molecules of chlorophyll, and then it hops in an essentially random diffusive way until it finds the reaction center where the electron and the hole separate. So you initially create an excited state. You promote an electron from the ground state in a molecule to the excited state. So you have an electron up here. You have a hole, electron missing down here, so we call that a hole. So you have this electron-hole pair that essentially moves because the next molecule, in the molecule over here, we have up electron, the next one, electrons down here, so this one moves over there, that goes up. So you have this sort of up-down process, so-called exchange or transfer, dipole transfer process, which will, in a diffusive manner, allow the excitation to move to this point here. So that was the canonical view. But these experiments back in 2007 that were done on this very humble bacterial system here showed that that didn't appear to be the case, and it was moving, the dynamics are more consistent with a wave. And the argument is it's a quantum wave, and I'll say why in a moment, but let me show you the canonical system, the E. coli, if you like, of this hydrogen atom of the quantum biology, which is this complex down here, the so-called FMO complex, after the three people who crystallized the structure back in 1977. And it's part of a very interesting and complicated light harvesting apparatus of a green sulfur bacterium, which lives in these shallow ponds. And green sulfur bacterium is here, and here's the chloroplast. Inside the chloroplast, we have a membrane. And in here, there's this little protein chlorophyll complex, which really isn't actually directly carrying the light. It's carrying the light, the excitation energy, which is created here in this very unusually large antenna system, is then transmitted through this little complex here. And the reason that this was studied is because crystal structure is well known, so the structure is represented here, and the little red things inside are the heads of the chlorophyll molecules. And if we strip this away, there's a different representation. Now the green are the chlorophyll molecules, and the gray is the protein surrounding them, putting them, embedding them in precise structures, orientations relative to each other. And then you take away the proteins. If you're a physicist, you'd like to reduce it to as simple as possible. Now we have seven chlorophyll molecules, just the heads are shown, because the heads are the part where the light's absorbed. And this system is so well known, it has a canonical numbering system. They haven't yet given them names, but their numbers are very well established. And now we have a system of seven chlorophyll molecules, which one could possibly attempt to understand quantifiably, the transport through from this side, where the excitation energy is coming through here, down to the other side, which is over here. Okay, so the way these are probed is with a method called, an experimental method called multidimensional, in this case two-dimensional, femtosecond spectroscopy. This is spectroscopy which is done on the time scale of 10 to the minus 15 seconds, very, very fast for a biological system. So we're probing things really at the beginning of a biological process. And what one does is one puts three pulses of light, which are on the order of 10 of these femtoseconds, into the sample. These pulses are so-called phase-locked. They are coherent with each other. And the time has they have a special time delays between them. And then one awaits the time, little t, after the third one and looks for a signal. And one looks for the signal at a point, specific point in space. So we have what's called a phase spatially and time, spatial and time phase matched signal coming out here, so you know where to look exactly for the signal coming from this particular set of wave vectors. And the important point here is, if you're a scientist, is, or a physicist in particular, the signal that's observed here is the electric field amplitude deriving from the polarization of the sample by these three electric fields. And because it's electric field amplitude and not an intensity, that tells you that essentially it's a quantum field. Yeah. So these are the methods that was used, and it's a very nice technique. So here's the FMO protein, goes here, also here. This is a kind of correlation between the two of those time signals, or more just Fourier transform to get two frequencies. And you do this for a particular value of the third one, and then you vary the third one, and you get this kind of amplitude plot as a function of time. And it's these oscillations here which reflect the quantum coherences. So that's what the past was about. If you aren't familiar with coherences, this is a very classical analog using old-fashioned 19th century technology to show you what coherence is. So here these five gentlemen are all peddling together in step so they can go forward. Coherence. if they were to pedal out of step, then they would be having more motion like this, and they would fall off. So by coherence, we mean that there's a stable relation between the corresponding locations of a wave in time and space. And that's what, I mean, with coherence, we can have these superpositions and the interference phenomena, and all the beautiful things that we know from elementary quantum mechanics. So, analyzing these dynamics that I showed you, the experimental signatures for, analyzing these theoretically has shown that the chlorophyll molecules, the electronic excitations in different parts of this complex, are actually entangled. And entanglement is a little bit more complicated an element concept than elementary quantum mechanics. So I've got here, brought here a perceptual analog for those that don't know what entanglement really means. The idea is that there's a non-local correlation between two objects. And in quantum mechanics, we only regard important, interesting entanglement as these correlations when they're between objects that are separated in space. So if you look at these two boxes here, they're rather close together, but they give you the idea. You can look at them in two different ways. Some people, when they look at them, see this. Or imagine these are wireframe representations. Some people see this, and other people see this representation. And if you're good, you can blink, open your eyes again, you can switch from one to the other. Okay, so your brain is doing a sort of like a measurement here, the analog of a quantum measurement which would collapse. What's an intrinsically correlated object which can be in, which exists in a superposition of these two states to one or the other. So what the situation here appears to be is that this complex which has these chlorophyll molecules which have the electronic excitation passing through them, the excitation can exist between where it's localized on both of the two chlorophylls at the same time. And this is a persistent entanglement. It's an electronic entanglement. And, okay, so it basically gives us non-local quantum correlations between the electronic states, between sites which are separated by up to about three nanometers or so. And so Schrodinger was very fascinated by entanglement. He actually coined the word. He said this is really the true characteristic trait of quantum mechanics. And it is, in a sense, a distinctive demarcation between a quantum and classical state. There's no classical analog. So what we found is that this entanglement persists up to as long as one can, as long as the actual process lasts, which is the order of picoseconds. It's long range, which is remarkable in a biological system when one takes into account the fact that the structure is not just these seven isolated chlorophyll. But one has all these proteins which are vibrating. It's finite temperature, it's room temperature, and there's a lot of water around as well. So it's quite remarkable that one would have on these timescales a persistence of such a fragile quantum phenomenon. So this is essentially the last slide. So the big question for a biologist is probably, you might say, well, this is very nice, but what does it tell me? We don't know what it really tells us for biology yet. The one first intermediate question is whether this coherence is relevant to long range, because most of, well, nearly all, with one exception, all of the experiments carried out today have been carried out like on this FMO in a single complex. But I've shown you before that PS2, which is really one of the most interesting systems for us on Earth, is a super complex, and it has many complexes. There are each one of these things here, which are the antenna complexes, is actually a trimer, and each one has 14 of the chlorophyll molecules, and they're all acting in concert together. There's one experiment on a larger system, the PS1 system, but it hasn't yet been analyzed. It doesn't have the detail because of to detect this coherence yet. The theory's been carried out for larger systems, and theory says yes, the coherence can be transmitted between the complexes, subcomplexes, and more specifically, the coherence is actually what allows the energy to go in this direction rather than that direction, or this direction, or in and out again. So the coherence gives unidirectional nature of transport. It also enables uphill transport. There are many cases where, although in general there's an energy funnel, In many instances, the energy has to go uphill for reasons other than efficiency of energy transport. And coherence enables you to go uphill much more effectively. Big, big question, which is not answered and I think is going to require input from probably molecular genetics and so on, is whether coherence and energy transfer gives us a biological, gives the organism a biological advantage. And here, in a sense, one glib answer is, well, everything that we know today does have this very high efficiency, so all the ones that didn't died out. But that's a glib answer, that doesn't really, it's nice, but no cigar. It doesn't really give us not a complete answer. So this is, I think, where we are today. In terms, also in addition to understanding the role of quantum effects in biology, this kind of study also allows us to think about re-engineering photosynthesis, re-engineering in a more biological way than one is doing today with photovoltaics and so on. And it also gives us lessons for design of robust and sensitive quantum devices. So we have here what appears to be a truly evolved natural quantum processor. And just in case we get too cocky, there's a long way to go if we want to really become energy efficient, and here's a little organism that really does it very nicely. It just actually eats the whole photosynthetic machinery and makes it work for itself. So we can think about that too. Okay, thank you.